All right, guys, welcome back to the Archon Team League Championships. Firebat went away before the break, and with us now is Radu, RDU, from Team Nihilum. How are you doing, man?
Really good. Here to cast some good quality games.
Quality games. Trump, how do you feel the next match is going to go? Team Liquid versus Tempo Storm. Any predictions about that?
Well, this is a big deal, because whichever team wins this one gets 3 wins, the other one gets 2. They're both 2-2 right now. And the difference between that right now is basically who's going to finish at the upper half of the pack and who's going to finish in the lower half of the pack. And if you finish in the lower half of the pack, you have a much harder time of getting further.
Right. You have to go through the redemption and then possibly a satellite, parts of the tournament to get back in the possible live finals. It's a little bit of a tougher climb, especially when all those the players you're going to be facing off against are pretty much all at the top of the Hearthstone rankings at the moment. So we're going to be going into a short spotlight video about Sho from Team Liquid before we move on to the next match. So yeah, enjoy.
I'm playing for Team Liquid. My name is Jaffe Brucey, and I play Hearthstone. As a Hearthstone player, I'm mostly known for being a warrior player, being rank 1 on both servers at the same time. But I think my best rank 1 on NA and rank 2 on Europe with warrior. The format of the team league is pretty different, so I kind of like it. I like it when it's new stuff. I'm not really fond of the Conquest format as it is now. It's Conquest now, but it's different because it's a team league, so I kind of like it. And we have to play 6 different classes, so there will be more versatility. Thank you for supporting me and my team. I hope we will do well, and I will try my best to be good.
All right, so we're getting on our way for the next match. Now, before we move on, a quick shout out to Alpha Draft. Thanks for sponsoring the tournament. If you guys want to check them out, alphadraft.com. You can draft a fantasy team. It's basically an esports league that you can participate in and maybe get a share of the $300,000 that they give away each week. Your first deposit will be matched up to $250. So give it a shot, alphadraft.com. Now, look at the lineups here. They're already being displayed for us. Does anything stand out to anyone, or does this look like what you'd expect these days from the metagame?
Looks super standard to me.
Yeah, same here.
Okay, so the Shaman is... I guess nowadays we're not as surprised. Initially, when the Archon Team League launched, you saw a Shaman, you were just blown out of your mind. Druid was also fairly uncommon. I think Team Liquid, though, not bringing the... what's the class I don't have right now that pretty much everybody brings in their lineup? Druid, I guess, Shaman, has kind of come back. Yeah,
one of those.
Yeah, I want to say Druid instead of Shaman is kind of more common, but a lot of players are liking Mech Shaman quite a lot.
Yeah, it looks like Shaman, Druid, Rogue, those three are about at the same tier level right now.
Yeah.
Honestly, they're all very, very close. Even though you see a lot of the top 4 decks being played, the classes, they're not that far away from like the next 3. Or even the next 4. Or possibly even the next 5.
Yeah. So what do you think of Tempo Storm not bringing a Rogue, RDU? Is that something you find a little odd? Or do you think Rogue is also a little bit weaker than it used to be?
Well, usually I would expect Hype to bring Rogue. But in this specific metagame, in this week, I think Rogue is just one of the worst classes. Like in the past week, it has been like really disappointing. Because they try to do too many things. They don't have like reliable card draw, they don't have reliable sustain, they don't have reliable damage, and they don't have reliable heal. So unless you draw the cards in the perfect order or get some really good matchups, every class can beat you. You can get rushed down by Patron, you can get rushed down by Druid, by Shaman, by everything.
Okay, so it's like, it's not a matter of the class being bad, it's that sometimes it just doesn't get the, the setup of the whole prep sprint. That will win you games, but if you don't have it, if you don't find your prep, I get the feeling Rogue often just falls flat on his face. I think, like, prep is just so key to the matchup. I kind of see what you mean.
Yeah, it's also a matter of how the 4 most popular decks being brought to the Archon League are all either even or have an advantage against Rogue.
Okay, well, I think 50, yeah, you're right. I mean, you have Hunter, Warlock every single time. You have Patron Warrior as well, always brought. And Freeze Mage is a really tough matchup. So unless the metagame switches to a different type of mage, then maybe Rogue would come back. But even then, there might be just better alternatives.
Well, it just turns out that the Rogue is really good against like the four classes that are often not brought, like Priest, Paladin, those classes.
Yeah, Shaman as well, which isn't too bad. Like you can get a good Blade Flurry and wipe the board out pretty fast. So we'll see how Nerea pilots it though, because he's a very experienced Rogue player, and you know he's been known to play it, and he's been having great success with it in the past. Well, Sho's gonna be playing as Hunter versus Gaara's. I'm guessing I want to say Shaman just because it's cool, but I don't know if he'll start with that.
We'll see.
Shaman is really bad versus Hunter.
Really well matched right now. They're both 2-2, and they only have one tiebreaker win between them. Team Liquid at 21 wins, Tempo Storm at 20 wins.
So they're really close to the point where over the next 2 weeks the difference might be almost negligible. So today could be a really big deal, whereby one of the teams gets a huge game wins lead over the other one, and that sets the other one very far in the pack. So it turns out we're going to be seeing Hunter mirror match.
Hmm. It's worth mentioning that Celestial, who just finished that, only has 17 game wins, and or 18 rather. And that means even if one of these teams goes 0-6 right now, they'll still be ahead of Celestial in the tiebreak. So Celestial is rooting for one team to really crash and burn this week. And one of these two teams is really one of their targets.
This is kind of disheartening for Team Celestial, though. If you think about it, like, you come in here, it looks like a really cool event, then the first 3 weeks are a disaster, but there's still time, and then 2 weeks afterwards, it still hasn't recovered, I guess. At this point, they're going to keep doing their best, but the odds of them really passing on to the next stage are pretty slim.
Do they have any mathematical chance to not lose instantly?
If everybody else loses, like, 0-6 or something?
It doesn't have to be quite that bad, but the teams which have two wins right now need to lose rather poorly.
Well, it might happen today, at least partially. It would be a really crazy thing to see the first win for a series that doesn't end up in 6-3, because that's the worst we've seen so far. We've never seen anything worse than this. So if somebody goes like 6-1, that would just be devastating.
Yep. Looks like hybrids from both sides.
Right.
One side's showing a Wolf Rider, the other side showing Abusives and Glaivezukas. Yet still holding Shredders, which is more of a mid-range thing.
Yeah, Hybrid is very... It looks a lot like Face. You almost can't distinguish them until you start looking at, you know, three, maybe the five cards, that suddenly you're like, oh yeah, this is a completely different deck.
I think Leipzuka is really important in this matchup. The player that gets it first usually has like a huge advantage. Not in this situation because of the Mad Scientist, though.
But is it that bad even in this situation,
plays
though?
Right now. There's a Knife Juggler, Break the Creeper play, there's the Glaivezuka play, and then if you decide to go with the Glaivezuka, you have to decide whether or not to try to trigger the trap.
Isn't the Glaivezuka more worth it? Just Glaivezuka and trade your Creeper, then you have two 1-1s the following turn that can proc the secret? Your opponent is forced to unleash double 1-1s if he wants to like negate the...
That's what I thought he was going to do, but he opted for another line of play, which I guess in this case is not going to be that terrible, but... in this case, he's still forced to unleash to negate the entire play, right? And if he doesn't have it, you stand to get maybe a tiny, like a better lead, maybe. Just a little bit.
Yeah, I mean, I liked this play too. It looks like it's going to leave something for the secret, and that's one of the times to get Knife Juggler to actually throw knives.
Right.
This play is better if your opponent doesn't have the unleash. And if you know for a fact he has Freezing Trap, because it's really bad versus Explosive. Having double 1-1s is obviously better than just sacrificing a Juggler for free. But the game can still go either way. We see Sho running Wolf Rider. People tend to go from Wolf Rider to Arcane Golem. Wolf Rider is better if you want to play him on turn 5 as a tempo play. And Arcane Golem is just as a finisher usually.
Yep, Sho playing the Unleash there tells Gaara that that is Freezing Trap.
I mean, Gaara is still maintaining initiative though, so he's in a pretty okay spot. If he goes for Juggler Abusive, he could try to snipe off the Hound and keep an extra minion, but then the question is, do you really want to keep an extra Spider to spawn a potential extra Hound? You've seen one Unleash, so what are the odds of a second one cropping up?
I think Zuka was better. You don't want to take the risk. I don't know. Gaara is really playing aggressive and taking the juggler risks. I don't really like this that much. But he's the hunter expert.
And there's a trade. If Sho had a freezing trap here in his hand to play, that would actually be a devastating moment. But no such thing. So about a high main, it's gonna come out a little later. Maybe almost too late sometimes it feels when it comes down.
No, if yeah, Gaara had a freezing trap.
No, Gaara did, yeah. I said if Sho had a freezing trap right now, that would be a really big deal.
Gaara's thoughts right now are whether or not to take the abusive sergeant trade or to just go with the shredder and face. I like this. Gaara's just pushing for damage.
Shouldn't you play the shredder in the middle in case you get Flametongue or Direwolf doggy?
Of course. I think everybody knows it at this point, but a lot of people are just autopiloting it. Yeah. It's like every time it comes up, you have to mention it just because. But the thing is, it's made a difference in some tournament games, right? Like, let's not lie, it has made sometimes a tiny difference where the traits had to be a little suboptimal as a result of that. But
You always have to root for them getting it to get punished so that they always play the shredder in the middle afterwards.
Yeah, soon enough we're going to have to play around Betrayal from the Spellslinger from Mage. Now that's going to get tricky. How do you play around Explosive Shot, all right? In that Mage deck.
Companion is a really good draw. If he gets Huffer, he can push a lot of damage. I think you still Glaive Zooka before, right? You Glaive Zooka and then you play Companion all face. And then you have Little with a Charger as a top deck.
I guess the only bet. What's the bet? Like, if Misha comes out, how bad of an outcome is that? You can always deal with a Shredder through Abusive, assuming you don't want to use Glaive Zooka.
Yeah, these outcomes are all good. I like Glaive Zooka companion. Yeah. I'll face no matter what, pretty much.
Yeah.
You might consider a trade if you get Misha. Ah, no.
Not even then, I don't think. Because they still have to make all the trades defensively.
For you.
Which is why the Savannah High Main comes in a bit too late in this game. It's like, it's just so awkward.
Yeah, the other possible play for consideration is Shredder Abusive, just because you generally have the mentality that you want to play the Shredders earlier. Those are slower cards, so it depends on how long Gar thinks this game will last.
That's a good point. That's a good point. And he makes the trades. Gets the freezing out of the way. And he's going to go probably for the Glaive Zooka, or he's just going to weave in more damage with Hero Power. Wow, okay, that is actually a really weird position. There could be, like, Unstable Ghoul coming out.
Wasn't it strictly better to just play Shredder if you go for this play?
I think it was. I'd say so, but then again... We're not in the player's mind. Now, I think he's got to turn on the aggressive gears. Like, there's no way he can actually just start trading without Unleash here. What do you think?
I don't really like the last turn that Sho had. It was, like, really weird. He went for proccing the Freezing Trap, and then he didn't play Shredder, which was, like, the best thing he could have played with that play. Then he went for Companion, which is, like, the aggressive play, which you would do if you go for face. So a lot of inconsistency in that part.
Yeah, at the same time, though, I appreciated him bouncing a 1-1 with the Freezing Trap, which is the only way he could have done it with that line. But yes, I do agree the play after should have been Shredder Abusive instead, in which case he would have basically an extra... I mean, he'd have another Shredder and Abusive Sergeant right now.
Maybe just Shredder and keep the Abusive for the Companion next turn. You can also feed the Hero Power, but yeah.
Alright, well, the...
head on the race.
Sho's pretty low on health right now. He's so far behind Joyce. I think Sho's gonna have to force Gaara to get like a miracle Shredder drop that's just terrible in order to get out of this. What kind of awful card could your opponent get from that? Even Doomsayer is bad for you because he gets the initiative again. Oh man, that can't feel good.
It's a desperation play. There's like nothing, if you think about it, that can help you.
Well, I guess if he gets like... What kind of zero attack, man? Like, Nathpiggle off the Shredder might actually make Sho stay in the game. Yeah. Like a completely crappy card.
I'm
There's
appreciating
a chance
this
the
play.
I'm liking this. I really like this play.
Yeah, it's pretty good. There's a chance he doesn't have it.
Ooh.
Okay. Oh, it's still not enough, right? Is it?
That's enough.
Yeah, it's more than enough. Well, slightly more, right, actually.
Oh, yeah, it's enough. For some reason, I thought they have different, very based HPs. I didn't look carefully.
Well, without the kill command, though, the game could have been a little closer, and the Edge might have gone to Sho, who I really like the play that Sho made with the Shredder trades, like killing one of them with kill command, and then going face for 8 with the Savannah High Main. That turned out to be, a potential winning line of play.
That's right. Gaara ended up being on the board 3 less than lethal. Abusive would have put it 1 less than lethal, and in that case, Gaara would have been forced to trade off, and then the game could have continued.
Yeah, and maybe given Sho, a top deck that could have ended the game. All right, well, that's already 1-0 for Temple Storm in the Hunter Mirror match. So the Hunter's locked out. Gaara already being done with it. He's got a Shaman left in his lineup. Do you think they'll just queue him up again? I've noticed that a lot. You know, a lot of teams tend to just get one guy and throw him twice. If he doesn't lose the first one, and keep going. Like, RDU, is there any... how do you guys operate? Like, do you just throw one guy until something goes wrong, or...
Well, I don't think I want
of
to
course,
reveal the
of
strategy.
Of course, Adi. Yeah, you know what? I shouldn't have asked you. It's pointless every single time. All right. Yeah. So how do you not do it? Like, give me all the ways in which you don't do it so I can reduce it to that one way you actually operate.
It depends to the opponents. Yeah. Like, okay. It depends every single week. You don't really want to create patterns. We all know that Tempo Storm got Kaldi in the analyst role, and he's figuring out, like, the strategy for them. And, that's something you should take care of. For example,
speaking of analysts, Team Liquid has Monk, and he's got like so many statistics and data. I'm kind of jealous.
Yeah, it's easier to play like that. You just like play your Hearthstone game and not care about the external factors. It's way easier having an analyst. But the funny thing is that the team that doesn't have an analyst is first in the league.
Well, actually, you guys all, like, you're all great Hearthstone minds in the first place anyway. Like, you're all good standalone players. So there's really no doubt about, like, the power of Nihilim when it was formed. We all pretty much knew, you know, this is going to be a great team. And you've proven it, I think, at this point. But then again, you know, do you? Don't speak too soon. There's still 2 weeks to go. Disasters could hit. Although you guys are, like, you're in a great position right now at first place. I don't think anybody can equalize this week. They would have to do it next week. And you would have to lose, I think, one match.
There is a chance that we have top 4 guaranteed, right? Even if we lose the next two.
I'm not completely sure. I'd have to look at it. But yeah, I mean, you guys are in a really great position right now. And a lot of the other teams aren't too far away from each other. So they're still vying for those, Trump mentioned that earlier, those mid-game slots. And getting second place or, you know, third and fourth instead of fifth is a really big deal.
It's a really stacked
the number of game wins is going to be a big deal. And I think that is a good tiebreaker because just how many games you win.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's see... they end up doing so. Hyped here playing nothing. Oh, he's playing Warrior against Savicha's Shaman. I actually don't know too much about this matchup, and I'd like some input. RDU, anything?
I know a lot about this matchup. Like, I played Shaman quite a lot, but on ladder I almost only play Patron Warrior. I can say that if you don't get the Fiery War Axe and they have a 2-drop, you're pretty much insta lost. And I like the Shaman in this matchup. I think the Shaman is favored a bit, not by that much. If the Warrior player plays really well, he can tie up the edges. What do you think, Joe?
Yeah, I was going to ask.
The faster the Shaman deck is, the better it is for the Shaman. Is that right, RDU?
Yeah, I agree with that. Because, like, Fail Reavers don't really matter. They get executed easily and dealt with easily. And same with Fire Elemental. He's too late to the party. But if you have, like, Lightning Bolts and double Lava Burst to, like, just go for face,
and
that's really
Leroy.
Hard for the Patron. And Leroy,
I think that this is pretty close. Kibler is the player on our team who's played Shaman a lot, Mech Shaman. And, this one's got Ragnaros too. Is Ragnaros too late to the party, or is he fast enough with his insta-bolt that he's good in this matchup?
I
like Ragnaros in this matchup.
I hope Savich isn't playing Mech, okay? Because this is not a hand you're looking for. Like, I absolutely hope he's not running a Mech deck, because this is not going to work out. I saw him facepalm really hard, so I'm guessing... it might be just a terrible mech draw.
I know why he facepalmed. He threw away both first strikes, I think, and he got first draw.
Oh my god!
So he's just drawing like I did yesterday. Now he'll get a Doomsayer and all the Twitch chat will say that he's lucky, when actually he drew the worst hand possible.
Oh man, we've got a Control Warrior there from Hive.
Yeah, he brought that last time. I'm pretty happy to see it again. Speak to me.
controller here. I still think Mech Shaman is favorite, pretty, probably even more than versus Patron.
Okay, it's mid-range Shaman, I'm guessing, against Control Warrior. I'm getting flashbacks from 6 months ago.
I actually don't know if this is mid-range Shaman yet or just the worst Mech Shaman draw ever.
Well, I know that mid-range is pretty heavily favored in this matchup if they play it right. If they know what to expect, that it's going to be Control, then they've got a great matchup.
Yeah, especially, like, Civitz and I have kind of seen... I've seen Civitz's Shaman play from way back, and he's a real big fan of hitting the button as Shaman, especially against Control Warrior, and that's how you win the game. You just hit the button a lot. Oh, and it's run. Possibly Mech Shaman.
Oh my goodness.
That's a nice end.
I don't even know what to say to Civitz right now. We should send him flowers.
This is the problem with Mech Shaman, it's super inconsistent. It's one of the most inconsistent decks. I wonder how Mech Shaman will look like, or like Aggro Shaman if you want it this way, after the new cards are gonna be released in the Grand Tournament.
The card draw, like the Ancestral Knowledge.
Spell damage totem there. Missed though.
Never lucky.
And the Brawl from Hype as well, bad. Can reset the board.
He's so. Denied both of the Acolyte of Pain, so Hype was probably hoping to draw more than one card off of the two Acolyte of Pains.
You mean it's not a good investment? 6 mana, draw 1 card? I thought that was great.
Not so good. Though it did pull 2 cards from the opponent, so at worst it was break even, but you're looking to do more than break even with Acolytes.
A little late to the party, but hey, I'll take that, I guess. It just has to spawn something that has more than 1 health, because that would be a big problem.
Yeah, on the bright side, Savita has a good 6, 7, and 8 lined up.
Yeah, but isn't it too late versus Brawl versus Execute and stuff?
With Ragnaros, I mean, it might be fine. It might be just enough if the Fire Elementals can bait some removal. Maybe Dog Turbo and a Rag will get to do something relevant. Oh, wow. A buff on the Healing Totem? Is this real?
That's really unfortunate that he got a one-attack minion, because now he can't Fire Elemental Lilitha.
Yeah.
Don't you steal Fire Elemental face?
That sounds like a great play.
Smork it up a bit.
So that now with Savich's luck at this point, I'm almost expecting Hype to Brawl and Lothep comes out. That's where this is headed. If he ever brawls, he keeps the minion.
That's a really high value Emperor Thorsten. Do you just boom as Savich and go for full face and ignore the board? Or Fire Elemental Earthshock? Do some trades.
I think you're a bit too far away to leave Thorsten on the board.
Against a Control Warrior, yeah, probably.
Well, you expect him to brawl if you play Dr. Boom. They cannot leave the board like it is, because the Mech Shaman can always have like a lot of burst in his hand. Hype doesn't know if Savage has like minions to burst. So if Savage goes for like a really aggressive line of play, Hype might think he has a lot of burn, and then he'll maybe use the brawl.
Yeah, but on the other hand, with Dr. Boom, you might just get... Well, in this case, we see that Hype has a good answer in Shield Maiden, Armor Up, Shield Slam, but you can always just get BGH'd or just executed with some small thing, Taskmaster Execute. Denver Thorstein is just too dangerous, I think. But I see the merit in the face play, and I think that's a very spirited play. I myself would probably go with the Fire Elemental and trade off the board, but this is a nice middle ground, too.
Yeah, I mean, the Brawl doesn't really take out all that much, because it really just takes out Boombots, which came from Dr. Boom, so it's not as though you're losing, you know, Cogmaster, 2 Mech Warpers, a Zap-O-Matic, and a Spider Tank to it.
It really depends what survives if he brawls. Like, if Boom survives, I think Savish can still win it. No. Then he, like, plays Ragnaros.
Yeah, if he brawls here... I mean, he doesn't even have to. He can just Shield Maiden, Armor Up, Shield Slam, like, and kill the Annoyotron. Like, he's absolutely not forced to go for the Brawl.
Yeah, I think Shield Maiden is the play here. You don't really need to Brawl. You can, like, Ragnaros if you know you to hit Dr. Doom.
I'm sure that's rigged. A great line of play. Yeah, sounds good.
I go for the 20%.
Reminds me of the old Amaz plays from a long time ago.
Amaz is Ragnaros. Always his face, though.
Yeah, it changed. He's like, you know what? New expansions came out. You've left me alone for so long. You don't play Priest. I'm out.
Yeah, Alright, well, tough spot for Mech Shaman right now. The opponent is at over 30 and has the board.
Doomhammer with, like, Doomhammer is one of the few things I could see maybe help, but then there's Alexstrasza that can be used offensively in this position, and that's also an issue, because the Shaman has literally zero heal in this specific deck.
This is a little bit of a tough spot for Savitz, because you really want to play Ragnaros, but you also kind of want to fight. Oh, wow.
Wow.
Wow, that's sick.
That is so insane.
What? That is like perfect. One of... Yeah, that's like one of the ways to make a comeback.
A little bit of a bright spot for Savitz. Like, he needed that. He's been getting not so lucky previously. He evens it out. And hey, even Void's playing Ragnaros into BGH.
So, what he's looking for here, like, do you brawl here or do you not have to? Because it's kind of a small value brawl if you think about it, really. I think offensive Alex is so much more dangerous.
Well, yeah, it guarantees you 8 damage to the face, and you can play like Fiery War Axe Ragnaros next turn and win, because Ragnaros will hit face.
Wow. Yeah.
Did you just go for the Ragnaros?
This damage is starting to come in for Savitz. He can actually trade away that Fire Elemental if he wants to. See, the positioning of it is now looking a little weird.
You might just want to Rug. It's either Rug or Flame Tongue between the 0-2 totems and play Fire Elemental face and go for full face. I don't think you trade here. You're not in a spot where you want to trade. Because in the long run, you're gonna lose. Oh, he's trading.
Nice hit. Doesn't even have to use the Rock Biter on this if he doesn't want to. You can just use Fire Elemental to kill this. But then I guess you're giving your opponent a better brawl, which is sort of what you've been trying to avoid. So, do you value keeping the totem over?
Oh man, if you knew what the opponent was holding, the best play would be to just totem here. But yeah. It'd be very impressive if Savitz had that kind of patience. Like, you do have to kill your opponent.
But now there's a good chance the 6-5 comes out, right? Like, there's a good chance. And... Oh, well, he's gonna have the answer no matter what. If a 6-5 comes out, he's got a good answer.
Yeah, there's no way you have that much patience. I've
had answers no matter what Savitz played.
Yeah.
But the best thing that Savitz could have done if he had full knowledge of Hype's hand was to press the totem button. But I think overall this is the right play. And actually, if he was going to play the Fire Elemental, I think it would be even better to Fire Elemental the remaining minion from Hype's side instead of sending in the totem.
Now here's a crazy thought. If he uses BGH instead of Execute, Ragnaros could be useful.
Yeah, well, it's possible that, well, it just gets executed.
Again, yeah. Actually, you could Rock Bite one minion, play Rag, hope the other one dies. And then he plays Rag, it hits your face. You silence your own Rag, you dub that Wind Fury, you win.
This could work.
That is very optimistic, right?
Hey, don't be that guy.
Don't you kill the Tutu? You kill the Tutu for sure, right?
Really? Well, I guess Grom, yeah, okay.
Oh, man.
That's actually a good hit.
So he's not gonna die to Fire War Axe Rag. Actually, yeah, he does. Never mind. He's. Rest in peace.
Wait,
how did we not think of the axe?
That is one of the reasons you don't want to die to like Deathbite or Axe plus the Rag, because you know he has some close reducted cards.
Well, he lives. Not that it matters very much. Actually, it could matter a lot. If he actually dodges Ragnaros for multiple turns in a row, this Annoyotron and this Stone Claw could be a problem. So Rag has to hit the Noyotron, and the Zap-O-Matic needs to what does it need to do? Get a Flame Tongue.
Just stay on the board for 2 turns, really.
Yeah, that is not happening. Well, if Noyotron gets hit here, that's pretty good. But then the health of the warrior is still way out of range. Never mind.
That's a bit
overly optimistic.
I guess Hype won the Russian roulette game.
Well, that was still a pretty good game, either way. Just that Savitz had the terrible hand. Like, there's no worse hand. I thought it was mid-range Shaman. That's how bad his mech hand was. Like, for that to happen...
Yeah, I wouldn't call that good. But, you know, Savitz made the most of his hand there. It actually looked like he had a chance at the end. And sometimes with mech Shaman, that's one of the nice things when you make your mech shaman have the high cards like Dr. Boom and two fire elementals and Ragnaros. If it does get to late game, you still have a chance.
It's kind of like Hybrid Hunter, right? Like, it reminds me of the way you remove some of the pure face and you're playing a bit more of the high curve to compensate for your weakness to those decks. Well, that's 2-0 for Temple Storm. Taking a pretty good lead, but then again, we're still in the very early phases of the match. You know, Conquest tends to come down to, even if there's only, you know, one deck left for Temple Storm to win with, sometimes Team Liquid can line up, you know, 4 wins against it and then end up at 6-4. Or the other way around, of course. So we'll see how that ends up going. I wonder if they'll push Hyped or Gaara again, or if Eloise will come out. I know she's a pretty good handlock player.
Yeah, Zoo too. She could be playing either one.
Does she have a preference? I've seen mostly handlock from her, but I haven't really seen much of her Zoo play.
I've seen a good amount of it. Probably the preference is just based week to week, depending on opponent.
All right. Do we expect Tempo Mage from either of these teams? I don't think Neria would bring that. I would be very surprised. Eloise, Tempo Mage. What are the odds? Not too sure.
Not really. Tempo Mage is like really subpar. Mech Shaman like is Mech so Shaman. Much better.
Yeah, but it's as inconsistent as Mech Shaman, right? Like in the same way we were talking about that earlier.
Yeah, like the only reason to bring Tempo Mage is if you're not sure on what... Mech Mage is if you're not sure what Tempo Mage is the best. And if you're sure your opponent is going to run Druid and maybe Paladin too.
Yeah, I could see that. Now, guys, if you want to post some comments about the league, feel free to do so. Just tweet hashtag ATLC. It might just get read up on stream. Any comments, predictions, and whatnot. Now, Temple Storm has Druid and Shaman left in their lineup. They still have to win with those two. And, you know, those are kind of the underdog classes, so to speak. Now that Rogue is kind of put on equal footing with Druid and Shaman in many respects, you could almost say that there are, you know, four top classes and five that could be swapped in and out on a whim. So do you think any of those two classes is going to be the biggest issue for Temple Storm?
I really want to see the Mech Shaman mirror.
What does it come down to? Who gets Zap-O-Matic?
If Another it troll? Goes to early game, but if it goes to mid game or late game, if the version with Fel Reaver should be favored, because Fel Reaver is really hard to answer from the Mech Shaman that doesn't have Fel Reaver. Like, I assume Gaara runs the non-Fel Reaver version and Savage runs the Fel Reaver version. Oh, and well, it goes to that.
Wow.
Let's see.
This is insane. Okay, well, hopefully we see some Fel Reavers coming from Savage. It's a card that's been cut out by a few people because I remember Brian Kibler ran into an interesting situation where he didn't play Fel Reaver on the coin because he was afraid of BGH, and as a result, the question then came up, which is, if you're not willing to play an 8-8 on turn 4, then why are you playing that over Fire Guard Destroyer ever? So, people started putting the Fire Guard Destroyer in.
Yeah, that's a good reason. But Fire Guard can also get BGH'd in some situations if he goes 7-6.
Yeah,
but at least you have a 75% chance.
Of course. I think
that's a good way of putting it. Yeah, if you're not willing to play that card when it's best played. But it's dependent on matchup, and you had to read that there's VGH. Also, in that particular week, Nilum brought quite a VGH-heavy lineup.
Yeah, you have to look at how many VGH the people used to run to know if it's worth it to run with a Fel Reaver or without Fel Reaver. I think the more aggressive version that Gaara is probably playing is the more consistent one, even though that can also draw really badly from time to time. Power Mace is a really important card in this matchup. Actually, it's important in every matchup. I don't think there's any matchup where you throw it away.
No, we'll see. I wouldn't be surprised. Like, there's no reason not to keep Power Mace unless you're really looking to smoothen up that, you know, turn one, turn two with minions to get the edge on your opponent's Shaman, which you have to assume is mech as well.
Wow, that's
what
the
a crazy start from Gaara. Oh my god. What? All we're missing is a mech warper, right? Oh my goodness. It's not as though
the pizza set looks pretty good too, but here's the downside of going second. Your Cogmaster loses to the Cogmaster.
Yeah. It's exactly as in the Mech Mage mirrors back in the day. Whoever starts first with and has the Cogmaster has the advantage. The problem with Mech Shaman is that the lack of consistency comes from running only 200 of the two Cogmasters. You don't really run more than that, so it's really hard.
It's a really good call from Gara to play this card, because it's an anti-power mace.
Yeah, and like it's interesting to think that Clockwork Gnome never really made its way in Mech Shaman. When you think about the card and how prevalent it was in Mage, obviously because, you know, spare parts, which is beyond insane, and if you could get even a turn 5 Blast Mage, it was crazy, whereas here it's a little less relevant very often.
I played one Clockwork Gnome yesterday in my Shaman deck.
How'd that go?
I won, but the Shaman went 1-2, so not that great.
Yeah.
Yeah, the Clockwork Gnome in Mech Shaman just doesn't quite have as much synergy as in Mech Mage. You can't do a 5-drop with the Blast Mage. You don't get the spare part for Antonidas. The spare part is really the key difference. It's a lot better when the spare part is a Fireball.
So, I have a question here. The opponent has a Power Mace up. Your Zap-O-Matic could become a 5-4. I mean, that's it. It could become a 5-4 minion. Unless he's got a Rock Batter weapon or Earth Shock, he can't really remove it. So, do you play that and the Cogmaster instead of the Shredder?
I think it's pretty solid because you can play Doomhammer into Shredder in the following two turns and it fits the curve perfectly. Well, not perfectly this turn, but you can still drop the Cogmaster, which you wouldn't be able to drop if you went for Shredder now.
So you'd be delaying your curve by not playing Zap-O-Matic and Cog right now.
Yeah, like if you don't play them now, when would you play them?
No, it's always a little tempting to just play the card which is the most mana on a turn, in this case the Shredder. But in this case, just because the 5-4 gets out of range of that and so much damage if it lives. And also because of what RDU said, Doomhammer and the Shredder is a perfect next two set of turns, so...
That's a good pickup. That's pretty much exactly what he... Like, I guess Earthshock would have been miles better, but this will do the job.
This forces Gara to play off curve and not use Doomhammer because he wants to buff the...
Yeah, it gets 6 damage in.
Yeah.
Ooh, although... I might have almost done it, just based on Lava Burst. Because you could have gotten the 6 damage in anyway.
I think Gara always plays the Shredder on the side to trigger me for some reason.
Oh, RDU is triggered, everybody run away.
He like tries to play it on the side, that's what is funny. Never in the middle.
Well, that's gonna be the end of the game already. Gara's gonna be able to steal it with the Lava Burst and that 2-2 Hyena popping out of the Shredder.
And Savish is benched.
Did he lose the last game? Yeah, actually.
Yeah, he lost with Mech Shaman twice
You're
in
right.
a row.
Right, Mech Shaman twice in a row, so Savich is going to be benched. Although at this point, the problem isn't as, it's not as big as in the, I almost want to say, later stages of the game, because there's still two players with a full roster of decks available to go. But we're looking at 3-0 right now. That's a pretty convincing start from Temple Storm. Gar is already locked out. Like, you know, he's done with his decks, he's done with his day. And Hype's only got one deck to go. Eloise is the only player with no wins at this point.
There are so many
mind
games
here is
now.
Team Celestial. They're hoping
snap.
For 6-0 sweep.
Right.
There are a lot of mind games now. Like, when you see Savish with the Mech Shaman being benched, you want to play the Druid. But if you play the Druid, you have two downsides. Number one, your opponent is going to expect that you play the Druid because it's the worst deck versus Mech Shaman. And number two, let's say you play the Druid and you win with the Druid, which has like a lot of favorable matchups, only Hunter being bad. Then you have only one player remaining, and one player is easier to target. So I'm not sure if Temple Storm will go for the Druid, but Temple Storm can expect Liquid to go for the Hunter just in case it's Druid. So then if Temple Storm are really smart, they will go for the deck that contacts Hunter the best, which would be either Zoo or Freeze Mage, if that's what Eloise is running.
And then if they think they're going to be playing Freeze Mage, they might play Grim Patron Warrior, and if they expect that, then they...
I think this one's fairly simple. You just 100% play Druid here because... the counters to Druid here on Team Liquid side, you just really wanted to dodge the Mech Shaman, and then you're happy enough. There's so few decks remaining on Tempo Storm that you take the chance to pull the Druid against anything other than Shaman. It's just, you could just announce it, I think.
Yeah.
Like, I'm playing Druid. And
I'm still not sure about that. I really want to see what the two analysts of the teams decide to go for. I think it'll be a mind game. You don't really want to leave Eloise as the single player because they can target her so easily.
I don't really know about that, because if you're down, if you're 4-0, then it's perfect. You're in the perfect situation. It's like, okay, you only have
even
two
with
left,
bad but matchups, you're still going to likely win everything. Like, assuming a 70-30, you're still likely to win with those decks.
You're going to get the bad matchups eventually. This is the time to pull out the Druid. It is the dream situation. You somehow managed to dodge Shaman. In fact, Team Liquid might have brought Shaman out again because they had played Shaman previously, or is that right? I think so. Which would mean that they might have been trying to trap the Druid. So their attempt to trap the Druid failed by sending Savid sub twice. So this is Team Tempest Storm's chance to capitalize on it, bring the Druid.
Well, that's the reason, if they know that they will bring the Druid, you go for the Hunter, which is like really good versus Druid. So
it's not
if
even
you have
that
another
much better, though. Like,
it's decent.
Really,
it's a decent upside, but it's not like, 80-20. So, I mean, ultimately, the Druid, even though it might run into a bad matchup, has more good ones than bad ones. So we'll see what ends up happening. And it is Druid against the likely Patron Warrior from show. I guess if it's not Patron, I guess they wouldn't have put it out.
Yeah, if it's not Patron, then they made a horrible mistake.
Yeah, a terrible one.
Well, Patron is also pretty good versus Druid. I will think he's like 55-45 for the Patron, unless the Druid runs like Woozens, other gimmicky cards.
Zixel says, like,
even though they pulled a matchup which is favored, it's like only 55, and it's good to get the Druid in when there's only three remaining decks. Take a 55 for it. Like, it's good for Tempo Storm to bring a deck that right now that only has a 45% chance of winning, just
at
because
stage,
they are down to so many, so few decks. The matchups are naturally going to get harder.
All right.
Yeah, I guess
well,
it doesn't really matter.
Let's see what they have. Show is playing Patron. That's a given basically at this point. I mean, maybe the new expansion will shake things up a bit, but for the time being, you pretty much have to expect Patron mostly with some Control Warrior on the side.
Yeah, I mean, this week we've actually had two out of the 8 teams at least brought Control Warrior, because I know my team did. We just saw one.
Yeah.
Oh, you also brought Control Warrior, right?
Yeah, he did. Right. It was
a free win against Freeze Mage. It's good when everyone's pulling Freeze Mage.
Oh, I'm pretty sure Peyton is also a free win.
Hyped as good as Druid. Did you see that? He's a good Druid player.
Yeah. He needs a follow-up too for that. Oh, he got
there
it.
There it is. Pretty good.
Now he's going to top the Shredder, right?
Yeah, Peyton is not in a bad spot. They have Acolyte of Pain. He only needs Death's Bite to start making a lot of patrons and win.
Yeah, this the thing about Patron is sometimes you just have a mostly win hand. Like sometimes you almost auto win, and the way that you do that is you get the Patron, you get Inner Rage and or Deathbite, and you get one more. And he has two of those three. He just needs to draw one more thing in the next two turns. I've got the business. And going from Hype's hand, it would be very difficult to deal with these. Well, that goes with the BGH.
I like
Wasn't
this.
It better to play the Druid of the Claw? Because if you play Druid of the Claw, you are basically safe against everything, and then you play Acid Drake, and Acid Drake will be protected from the Deathbite hit. Well, if you play BGH,
yeah, but if you play Druid of the Claw, you run into execute problems, and then like Cruel Task execute could be an issue. We've seen a bit more Cruel Tasks, which is kind of weird, but it's happened. So I can see why he made that play. And using the Innervate to Mana Saturation later on, maybe getting, like, if he top decks Ancient of Lore or gets a Dr. Boom, like, there's a few plays that could make this a bit different.
I guess.
That's awkward. That always is, isn't it?
Would you ever consider running the Druid of the Claw or swiping just to protect your BGH, or is the BGH just expendable?
I kind of like the charginess. Having a 4-1 isn't that good, but it's something.
Maybe
plus,
four
charging it versus like taunting it isn't that big difference. It kind of is, but
yeah. So I guess his mana efficiency here was a tiny bit better, just because he didn't
both
use the
revival. And it just depends on who was playing the deck.
Well, Alright, so he's gonna execute this Jewel of the Claw. It's a pretty nice hand the Patron's got right now. He's got no combo, like he's got one combo piece with the Gurren Patron, but it wouldn't take too much for this to get out of hand.
Well, he used the Whirlwind already, so I think he needs a good set of draws to get out of this situation. On the other hand, Hyped doesn't have that much pressure, drawing combo bars too and the removal.
Oh.
Emperor is pretty good, but you need some more draw power.
Yeah, I think I would have been tempted to, innervate Wrath there.
Yeah, I think I would have considered doing it just to negate the possibility of a, like Fire War Axe plus trade or Cruel Taskmaster plus a ping from something.
In this case, it turns out to be a lot better. Wow. Like sometimes you save the innervate just so you can do exactly Force Savage.
Force Double Savage is going to be so insane. So he's going to be able to get his opponent down to 26. Just based off of the swipe and the Drake here. Assuming he swipes the 2-4, which we have to kind of... Although, could you Wrath the Gnomish Inventor and swipe face? Just to cycle and get something else?
Yeah, I was considering that play. I think you do it. Like, actually, you need Wrath for Patrons, but while having double combo, you don't really care about Patrons, because if they go for Patrons, they'll be exposed. And like, cycling is vital because you really want a 7-drop or anything playable next turn. You cannot afford to not have it, right?
That's what I was thinking, but apparently Hyped has other plans, and we'll see if they end up panning out. It's not necessarily a bad play what he just did. I think it's like the obvious play, and maybe he still thinks this game's gonna drag on and on. In which case, what he did was perfectly right.
It does a really questionable line.
Show must be feeling pretty good about the game right now. He's got a reduced hand of a lot of good stuff, and he doesn't have any enablers, but it seems to be a nice relaxed face.
Oh, wow.
Until turn 10.
Was that not a crazy pickup? So I think you swipe face, Wrath the Emperor to cycle, and then you just kill your opponent, pretty much.
Well, you cannot kill the Emperor with only that. It's only 4 damage.
No, you Wrath for cycle on the Emperor, and then you swipe face. Power, yeah.
Is that enough to kill it?
Well, you deal 2 to it. I don't know. You hero power it down, you go down 5.
Oh, you hero power it down. Okay.
Yeah, just to get more damage to the enemy's face. But then again, maybe I'm being too optimistic. And he's just going to go for 4. I guess your health matters too much in this matchup.
You can also swipe it.
Yeah, cycle that just to get something to play on turn 9.
Now do you innervate out Shredder? Like swipe?
No. You still do the same play that, as you said, and you just play Shredder next turn. You want the double combo for sure. It's something they don't play around. You cannot play around double combo. Let's be serious.
And what if he picks up Innervate next turn and that's just over then and there? This would be so nasty. The thing is, the Armorsmith from Sho risks putting a dent in the... Actually, do you just let the Emperor live? Or would you just die frequently to the following turn?
Since you need 2 turns, you don't let it live. This is one of those moments where, well, Sho's going to be very concerned on turn 9. That's going to be lethal with the 4 Savage, and given how this game has played so far, I think Sho's best suspecting that could be the case. He won't see the 24 damage combo coming, though.
Usually when you're in a bad spot as a Patron versus Druid, you don't play around combo. I learned that the hard way. You just ignore it. You just do your own game, try to set up Patrons and stuff. If they have it, they have it.
Yeah, but here's the thing. Your situation isn't bad right now. It's worth just slamming that to avoid dying. You can stabilize with Armorsmith, Whirlwind,
so,
Balorage.
My question is, does Hyped even bother playing a Shredder? Because if he does, he's giving potential Armorsmith value, if those exist.
I know you play Shredder for sure.
Yep. I think you cycle the Wrath also.
I think you're Wrath and hero power the Gnomish Inventor to have Shredder on the empty board.
Okay,
isn't that better?
That makes sense.
Great point.
Like, if they try to kill their Shredder, even Whirlwinds and stuff will not be able to kill both Shredder and the minion that spawns from the Shredder. So I like this play a lot. And your opponent will play around combo, but he will never play around double combo. That's something you never play around in any spot.
Well, he will be at least at 22 health, I guess. The thing is, the double Armorsmith risk posing a problem to you. The thing is, if you had 2, oh my god. Is that what he wanted? It kind of is, actually. You can play double Armorsmith with a Patron and get quite a bit of armor, but would that be enough? He could get an extra 8? What now? You could get an extra 6 and be exactly at 22. Oh my god.
He'll probably go for one Arma Smith and then try to draw with Battle Rage. That's what I would do. You don't expect double combo.
All right, let's see what he does. This is just a crazy possible turn. Let's see what Show sees.
He's on the ropes. It's always bad to play Patron on the ropes. You have to move fast usually.
He's gonna go for the play you mentioned. That's gonna be game then.
He's not gonna finish the turn most likely.
Yeah,
he will not finish the turn with Armor Smith, with Patrons, and with Shredders. There's like almost, and with Battle Rage. I don't think he finishes the turn. That's only the ability when playing Patron.
Yeah, I don't think he's even been able to attack the 2-draw that came out, did he? Oh yeah, he did, actually.
Did he also get attacked to the face?
I don't think so. That would be very surprising.
He didn't.
And yeah, the double combo.
There was the only play that Show could have made would be Shield Block, which would have not been the right play anyways.
And there we go. The obscenity of this is...
Yeah, Show just like, oh, no. Wild Growth on 2, plays cards on turn 10, or Savage. I don't know. Man, sometimes that happens.
Well, good on Hype for not using that Innervate earlier. You know, we did mention there was a few moments where we wanted to use it personally. You know, RDU wanted to use it to get out of the 5-drop earlier. We wanted to use it for Wrath. And Hype just kept it, and it ended up being the winning play. Anything else would have maybe just not been enough. Crazy.
It would get even crazier if Show also gets benched.
Like, now I just want to bring attention to the fact that Temple Storm is up 4-0. Eloise is highly targettable. Savisha is still benched. So Show and Neria have to get out the decks that they need. That they want to beat Eloise. But how reliable would that be? Like, she's got Handlock, I assume, and Freeze Mage. What do they have that just completely demolishes those?
Well, they have the Patron against the Freeze Mage. That's pretty good. And against Zoo, it's also pretty good. And against Handlock, it's really bad.
I guess Freeze Mage could be good from Neria as well. Like, you're getting a coin flip once, and I think you've got a small edge against the Warlock, perhaps. No matter what it is, basically.
That's correct.
And Show can almost not risk getting benched. Like, if he goes in and loses, Neria versus Eloise is all that's going to stay. That's going to remain in having the rogue locked up.
That'd be our first double bench, right? That's pretty exciting.
Wow.
Yeah, it'll be a 1v1. It'll be a 1v1.
Yeah, until Neria wins one game and then somebody else can come in to sub.
Well, if Show loses now, Temple Storm will be up 5-0. So if Neria loses one game,
it's over. Like, yeah. He has to win and unbench his teammates, basically.
Yeah.
Well, let's see what happens. I think there's a lot of pressure on Team Liquid's side not to send Show out. It's not as though, like, I guess you want to queue up Grim Patron here, but then if it's Handlock and you queue that into it, I mean, your matchup is not unwinnable. We've seen a lot of Grim Patron Warriors pull off the win, but not nearly as consistently as they'd like.
Yeah, I would say it's like a 15% or 20% chance that Temple Storm goes 6-0. They have like unfavorable matchups, but they're still like doable. 10% would be fair, I think. What do you think, Trump?
Well,
you're better with odds.
I think those are fair. So, like, I think your estimate is roughly correct. If the matchups were 50-50, then that would be 25% max. But of course, the matchups are going to be slightly less good. So, my estimate is somewhere between like 15% of a sweep here, 15 to 20.
Yeah.
Well, turns out they're going to go for that mirror match mage. And,
that's bad news for Team Liquid because they were hoping to get better than a 50-50.
Yeah.
When you only have 2 decks, like, it's hard to... When it's 6 decks against 2, it's really hard for your matchups to be less good than 50-50. So, when your LOE is 50-50, is about the best you could have gotten.
The way Team Liquid can win is using the tilt factor and hoping Eloise goes on tilt if she loses, like, 3 games.
Okay, sure. That would actually be... If Team Liquid comes back in, this could be a really big deal. If Eloise ends up losing, you know, 3 to 4 games in a row, that's a really big deal, I guess. Because your teammates did what they had to, and then you feel like you're the one who's letting them down at the very end there. Whoa, Mech Mage coming from Eloise. It seems to be the case.
Yeah, a hybrid even.
Yeah.
It's funny because Fair Reaver is one of the best cards versus Freeze Mage. And this kind of mage is
Actually that surprised me.
No, it's good. It's good. You definitely keep Fair Reaver on the coin. And now you destroy the Freeze Mage player with double Fair Reaver.
Unstable Portal though with Mana Orb?
Oh, she didn't keep a stable portal? Oh, okay, yeah, you keep it.
I would have kept that minion, but I guess she was looking for something specific. I can't figure out why you would want... Wait, what? Oh! Control Mage? Control Mage? Is this real? I haven't seen this deck in
might
about...
might be Freeze Mage with a Polymorph. Oh, wait, that's
and a Mountain Giant?
Mountain Giant.
oh my god.
Maybe it's Freeze Mage with one Mountain Giant. Why not?
And
the polymorph, it looks like an echo, or I think control is what it is, more so than anything else. And this is a matchup.
Yeah, in specific, has played this type of deck before as a control mage. He's also got a Sludge Belcher. This is really exciting. Is this the first time control mage is being played in Team League?
And it's actually a really good deck to play against those type of tempo decks. Like, it's not nearly as good as, let's say, Freeze Mage against a deck like Tempo Mage, where Freeze Mage would be a little bit better, but against a deck like the one that Eloise is bringing, which is a bit more of a mech version, then I feel like the addition of the polymorphs to the roster really are a great help, because Fel Reaver is one of your biggest problems is Freeze.
I like that Eloise always brings crazy decks, but I don't understand a Tinkerton Technician in this deck. It doesn't really fit, you don't really want to get that much value from him. Like, can you fit Antonidas, Boom, Tinkertown, Fair Reavers? It feels like a really weird deck. Also, Unstable Portal, which she threw away. So she wants to tell deck into it and get the Deathwing or something like that.
Yeah, but I guess the Unstable Portal throwaway, I actually think, was probably the biggest mistake I've seen today. Like, you have the Mana Worm, you have the 2-drop. I think Unstable Portal is a fantastic 2-drop. That's got to be one of the biggest surprises I've seen. What to
do? Yeah, I agree. Duplicate into Sludge Belcher is pretty good versus any aggro deck, but this aggro deck runs Fel Reavers, and Fel Reavers are gonna come down now. So is Sludge Belcher good enough versus that?
I mean, the thing is, you kind of don't want to play the Fel Reaver here just because you don't know if it's Mirror Entity, and so you run the problem of giving them the Fel Reaver, and then they get the initiative.
That deck is absolutely Freeze Mage in Eloise's opinion right now. Okay. There's no question. I think. Wait, no. You just attacked and Ice Spear didn't pop. So now you're scared.
That's what I'm saying. Like, there's a really big doubt as to what you're facing off against. But if you've got intel, you know, on Liquid, maybe you know Nerea is a type of player who plays very slow mages, which tends to be the case. So you're expecting Echo control, variants of mage that aren't exactly running Mirror Entity. And that was a great call from her.
Yeah, that was a bit of a risk. She threw the coin first, thinking maybe Counterspell, and then no. And then it had to be exactly those two secrets for it not to be Mirror Entity.
I actually like Eloise's line of play. She saw that it's not Ice Barrier, but then when she used the coin, she saw that it's not Counterspell, and Tempo Mage is, if they play two secrets, they play Counterspell and Entity, so if he doesn't have Counterspell, then it means that he doesn't have Entity either.
It has to be Vaporize, which it's not, or Duplicate, which I guess it is, and maybe an Ice Block. So now you know, and if the Counterspell hits the coin, then you can always Shredder on the back of it, I guess. So,
yeah,
really nice line of play. It covered pretty much all the angles, and now with Effigy coming up in the new expansion, oof, that's a rough loss, but ouch. And with double Fel Reaver, it might actually matter. You know, sometimes we say, oh, well, if you don't draw your entire deck, yeah, well, when you double Fel Reaver, maybe it ends up mattering just a little bit.
With Boomy Hand, it shouldn't matter, right? You still win with Boomy Hand.
Yeah, I think Fel Reaver again is the right play. You're going to draw only one more card from your deck if you do it, but I think that would be the play still.
You're only going to draw one more card. I mean, the Shredder and Dr. Boom are super high-quality minions anyway, and you've got your turn 6 kind of covered, if you wanted, with Shredder Ping. So
your game plan was never really to last past game turn 8 anyways, and you have Fel Reaver on turn 5, turn 6 you go Shredder Worm or Shredder Ping, turn 7 you go Boom, and turn 8 you play the rest. So no worries about destroying your deck.
You also don't expect the Aquamage to play more than one card next turn on turn 6.
Right, ever, pretty much. Oh, she's gonna opt for the Paladin Shredder, so she's going to try to keep a little bit of the deck. Maybe get two turns of draw. Lo and behold.
Tempestorm doesn't really like playing Shredders in the middle. Maybe they discovered something new about the Shredders.
You know what, RDU? Maybe there's something secret about the Shredder, where if you put it in the middle, it spawns Doomslayers more often. And they ran the math on the simulation, you know, and that came up.
Yeah, Reynard got the key to the Shredders.
Oh, damn. Smooth. Well,
I really hope she gets Direwolf Alpha or Flame Tongue.
This is miserable, RD. You don't wish that upon your, you know, friendly Hearthstone players.
What to do?
Well, Trump, you've never seen this matchup, have you? I'm curious because I personally haven't seen much of it, if at all. I know from my experience a little bit of how it works, but I can't say it's one that I'm familiar with at all. So.
Okay, well, there's two situations here. Either you're up against Control Mage, or you're up against Echo Mage, and you actually don't know which one. If you're up against Echo Mage, you really don't want to set your opponent that low to play around Moltens. If you're up against Control Mage, you do. It's one or the other right now, and if you are playing from Eloise's perspective, you actually have no idea which one it is. Let's see, so you can do 9 right now. I think 13 is a good number to set the opponent at, so this is fine to just go for it. Plays the big card to dodge the Flame Strike, has a Shredder. It's looking alright.
Yeah. Echo is actually a deck that runs 2 Flame Strikes. Whereas Control Mage sometimes has a little bit of a variant to it. You've seen Duplicate, so you still don't know which one it is until you see Echo of Medivh being played. By putting your opponent at 14, you're denying kind of the Molten Echo, but how could...
One reason why Control Mage isn't that popular is because Flamestrike is a really powerful card, but right now there aren't that many decks that are good to Flamestrike. Like, Patron is good, of course, mm-hmm. and everyone runs it, but other than that, there's just not that many decks out there which Flamestrike is good against.
It's also really slow and can have so many bad draws. Like, the way you win is by having Emperor into Duplicate. If you don't have that, your win percentage goes so low. In, like, every matchup, no matter what you play against. Like, Hunter is almost an insta loss if you don't run Molten Giants, right?
Yeah. This is not looking good at all for Neria. Right now, it's not looking very good for Neria. His early game couldn't compete at all with what Eloise got. I mean, double Fairy on its own is a bit of a nightmare. First size block is going to get popped. If Doctor Boom is played, then those 1-1s are kind of going to have to stick on the board.
I have to say, this is the first time in a very long time that I've seen a mage with Mountain Giant, though. So, cool to see that.
Yeah. It's kind of the new Warlock, right? Like, a while back when Mech Mage came out, everybody said, hey, Mage is the new Warlock, they've got so many archetypes. And it's still true, to a large extent. And right now, we're kind of looking at two decks that I didn't think would crop up today. At all, either or of them.
Here you want to do two things, kill the Acolyte, probably from one blow, and then put your opponent at 1 HP so you can ping every turn. And maybe play Boom too, even for one Boom Bot. Oh, you cannot play any Boom Bot, never mind. So you don't play Boom.
Well, you'd have to ping your own Sheep and Frostbolt. It goes nowhere.
Okay, that would actually be interesting though. You could send the Sheep into the Acolyte to die, and then you play Dr. Boom with one Boom Bot.
Mm-hmm. Just enough to threaten lethal if they decide to wipe the board with a Flamestrike.
Well, if you throw the Sheep, you just trade with Mana Worm 2 and then make an area overdraw for 2. Right?
Yeah,
well,
and
then play
Boom.
Yeah. But she's going to play it safe. There's no need to overextend here. I would almost ping my own Sheep to get it out of the way for the Boom Bots, but...
Yeah, it might have been better to actually overdraw him. Because overdrawing him doesn't really matter, but playing the Boom matters with the Boom Bot. Oh, Molten Giant. That's interesting.
So
Molten, it is an accurate deck.
Molten, Mountain, Ice Block, and then I don't know what you do. Like, I don't think you're getting out of it right now.
So basically, Nerea just plays Molten Echo Giants with a Mountain, and he didn't draw into his Moltens early on.
Yeah.
It's pretty unlucky.
I didn't expect Echo Mage. Wow, she's almost out of cards, but she's got two really powerful cards to end the game no matter what happens. I'm out of cards. Archmage gone? You're pretty happy, but you know there's a Dr. Boom somewhere in there. You haven't seen it milled. Actually, she has to trade, because Alexstrasza hit face is lethal.
I don't think you play around that, but yeah, you trade anyways.
No, yeah, in that deck, it's actually one of the few win conditions. Echo Mage wins with Alex quite often, almost more than the old Handlock.
You might even Frostbolt the other one, like kill one. No, you want to play Boom, never mind.
Yeah, so you actually, you know what would be crazy?
What? If...
Okay, that's confusing to me.
Well, with this one, you're just going to Frostbolt a giant.
Yeah,
definitely. Yeah, but wasn't Boom strictly better because you want to play around Flamestrike ping? So that your boar doesn't die.
Your shredder lives, so that's something.
Don't you want to trade the shredder into one of the giants? Oh, you don't. Oh, you can trade out something else, I guess.
We'll have to see what happens now, because now it's not quite over. He can Alex defensively if he wants to, right? Is that going to be enough to save him? I think it would be, since the giant's going to get traded into.
Not if she plays the spider tank. And then that's 15.
Oh, that's right. 15 damage, yeah.
16 even with the sheep.
I think she didn't ping it. Oh, wow. Oh my god.
And was there any reason to not play that?
This is so painful.
The reason not to play Spider Tank is to play around Flame Strike, I guess. But unfortunately, like, the Flame Strike is... Like, you win if he Flame Strikes most of the time. So
you're just being face. You win by pinging face. So anyway, he's forced to Alexstrasza.
Did he?
Which means that Spider Tank was absolutely essential because he plays on Alexstrasza.
Yeah, like if you play Spider Tank, you cannot lose because if he plays Tanks, you just ping. So Eloise is just through the game by not playing Boom or Spider Tank.
Well, let's hope not.
It's not a throw yet. She needs to clear off the board, though. Well, she needs to clear the
giant.
Just
ping a Boom bot and get lucky.
Oh, boy.
Huh? Oh boy!
Okay, that's okay.
That'll do it.
Yeah.
Wow, that is unreal. Oh. Eloise with the Boombot lethal. This was unrealistically lucky, I guess. I mean,
so
this was
close to my idea. Like, you almost had this grasped back in because of that.
Can we say 5-0? I just want to point out we're one win away for Eloise from a complete sweep. The first one in the entire Archon Team League, and it was actually exactly what Team Celestial need, maybe, to come back in at any point.
I'm trying to think of an outcome where playing Spider Tank was bad, but I cannot get any. So basically she went for the 15% win chance instead of the 100% win chance.
Maybe Blizzard? I don't know. I mean, obviously it's one of those situations where when you're in the game, maybe you don't think about it. You think you've already got it sealed up. So, I mean, it happens, right?
Yeah, it's a lot of pressure. Yeah. Actually, it's not that much pressure when you're 4-0 up, right? The pressure is at 5-5.
Well, I guess there's some pressure because your teammates just went 100% win rate. You're like, yeah, I gotta prove it. You know, I can do it too.
Maybe. If Nerea had one more ice block, playing Spider Tank might have not playing Spider Tank might be correct, but because he used both ice blocks and he was at 1 HP, I think you just play everything from your hand. Because if he uses board removal, you can just ping, and if he heals, you need to have enough to kill him. But anyways, what is the best pick to counter the Warlock?
With
the sick thing is you don't know what Warlock it is, but you can go off of past history.
And
let's
see. Is a mage good versus every type of Warlock or rogue?
Echo Mage is actually pretty good against everything that Warlock does. From my experience, I think it's one of the better decks against Warlock. But that's just for my own playstyle. I don't have any hard data. Like, I have no idea.
Last week, Eloise brought Zoo. So probably the right choice would be Patron.
And it's going to be Mech Warlock. I can already feel it. Fel Cannon. We're going to go Dark Onyx style with a Falcon control Warlock. It's happening.
Speaking of mech, though, Eloise had a very interesting addition to her Warlock deck last week. She had a Enhanso Mechano.
Right.
One of the first times we've seen that card.
Yeah.
Hunter is also good versus Warlock. Like, really good versus every type of Warlock, right? It's super good versus Maligos, super good versus Zoo, pretty good versus Handlock. more than 50%. So, Hunter? You want to get as many wins as possible, so you have to queue up the matchups in the right order. So now we'll see like what Team Liquid thinks is the best to face the Warlock.
I don't think midrange versus Zoo is that good. I think that's about 50-50.
Well, I don't think Sho is running midrange, right? He was running hybrid.
Hybrid Hunter, yeah. Like his opponent as well. They were both running hybrid when we saw them.
Yeah, they go for the Hunter.
Well, let's see how that pans out. I think it's a pretty good matchup. I think like midrange isn't that strong against Zoo. Face Hunter isn't that amazing, but I think hybrid is a really good one. If any of the Hunter decks are going to be working against a Zoo potential, I think hybrid is the one.
Actually, it turns out that face is really good and hybrid is less good, but
I found it the other way around, really. Midpoint. Interesting.
I think so. Because what's really good is the explosive traps and just the aggression. You can kill the Warlock before they get the opportunity to get the late game card advantage.
I'll take your word for it.
Face is really bad versus Hanlock, though. Because it enables Moltons really fast, and then you don't have a really good way to pass for towns.
I wouldn't call it bad against Hanlock, though. I still think it's favored, but this is where opinions differ.
Yeah, I think personal experience will sometimes dictate how you view a certain matchup. Now, double Unleash against a potential Zoo from Eloise is definitely something you're looking to keep.
Yeah, that's a really good start from Eloise. She's got the Flame to start, and she's got the Voidwalker to protect it.
Yeah.
I like the start from Show More with Juggler Unleash and another Unleash.
I think both players are getting a pretty decent hand at this point.
Yep,
but the early game like kind of goes to Eloise. It's just that once they're going to be maybe not anymore. Never mind. Wolfire is going to equalize this. Without a weapon, this juggler kind of gets the initiative.
Does take Eloise. The coin though, and it goes to show how good Voidwalker is in this matchup. It takes a coin and a 3-drop to kill the 1-drop.
Double juggler opener. On the turn 4. Oh wow, both players with double juggle.
Do you play the juggler? I don't think you play the juggler.
Your hero power and pass?
I think that you seems play like it.
You kind of have to.
And now let's see the esports from Eloise. She had like really good jugglers versus Ekop.
Well, if it happens again...
Yeah. It's a 50-50, right? It's a 50-50 to hit it.
No, it's more than that.
Three nice is a 50-50.
It's Arcane Missile situation all over again.
No, it's exactly 50-50.
Oh my god. Correct. Alright.
Well, here you
have Master for Battle versus Shade. It's like Master for Battle versus Shade.
Yeah, it's the same as Arcane Missiles to kill 3-2. Yeah. I remember that from a long time ago. I will never forget.
She got unlucky, you know?
Yeah. No, she did get the 50-50. That's not unlucky.
She just didn't get the perfect outcome.
After the first knife hit, it's not a 50-50 anymore, it's a 75%.
Right, right. It's true, though. Like, it depends on which of the systems you're looking at it from. Anyway, let's not go mathematical on this. There's a Juggler Unleash coming up. Calculate the odds. Go ahead, Raju, I'm waiting. How often does it kill a Juggler here?
I think you try the Shredder first.
Kills the juggler 100% of the time.
I was gonna say, with those little hounds, there's no way you're not.
Shredded Shredder before? Not really,
good point,
because you can get Mal'Ganis.
But you don't know, you don't know what comes out. I was gonna say, if it's Mal'Ganis or... God forbid...
I think you dodged the Voidwalk.
Doomguard. Yeah. But the thing is, it's actually going to be pretty sweet for Eloise. If there's no Freezing Trap coming up, I mean, Power Overwhelming Void Terror. Do you ever? It's 7 damage to face.
Yeah, is the winning play. If she top decks Doomguard, she's in a super good spot.
Oh, that's not it. But actually, it's not that bad. That's a 9 damage to face, and you get a huge Void Terror afterwards, and you keep the Abusive.
You can still tap into Doomguard.
And that would be insane. Oh.
Yeah,
that
you
would
could
be
do a super all-in play right now. That would be interesting.
You definitely tap because you cannot die to anything next turn, and you need to win next turn.
No, you don't necessarily tap. You could play every card right now and then hit face.
You lose to all.
You hit the opponent for 9 with the abusive and the void, and then you get a, let's see, that's a 9, 8. You would get a 12, huge 11 void terror, which could only be dealt, but it's all in because you get owled or you get freezinged or you get hunter's marked. But Sho might think that's like the best chance to win.
If she does it, oh my god, if she does it, oh my god, and that's actually not even that bad, is it? If she went all in, she'd get a free void caller on the back of it. Oh, she didn't do it.
She's right. Not going for the winning play.
I'm so sad right now. I am actually really sad. Deep inside, I'm crying.
Well, I don't know if you can call that the winning play.
I see where she's coming from, and I might not do it. The thing is, look at the amount of damage on the board right now. There's 6, plus another... She's got 12 damage. She's looking for 7 more. She can hardly find it right away.
Yeah, I don't know about that. I think the YOLO was the play. YOLO was definitely the play, right? Because you cannot win versus that ward.
If you draw Doomguard with tap, that would be 7, 9, 12. Still off. No, not quite.
Yeah. You're missing 2 damage because you didn't YOLO. Basically. Oh, no unleash possible for the time being. That's kind of amusing.
He still has lethal with abusive. But at this point, I don't think you play around any damage from the hand, right?
Well, yeah. I mean, you would have to kill something here if you want to stay alive. Then it's how do you win ever?
Eloise would have won if she went for full face. But yeah, of course, Sho could have something really easily. But on the other hand, do you really expect to win versus that kind of board? I don't think you do.
So just going all in might have been... turns. Yeah. There was no way for Eloise to win if she didn't... Like, if she'd done that like as a previous turn, she would have won.
Right. But now it's forced you out of desperation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now isn't just tapping for Argus a better line? Again, really, really inconsistent lines.
See, I don't think that was inconsistent. Like,
I think that was consistent with what she wanted. It's just that she figured at the end, well, now I'm desperate, I've got to do it. I think it was consistent with her initial idea of, I'll try to play a slightly longer game, and that didn't pan out, so then she tried out the all-in. I think it was consistent, just she didn't want to risk it too like early enough, I guess, in this case. Well, Team Liquid is going to unbench their player, and Eloise is going to lose the first game for Tempo Storm. So she just needs one more win. Again, even with a 20% win rate against the field, there's a chance she gets a win, right? With 6 more matches to go.
Yeah, now we need to calculate the chance of Team Liquid winning 5 in a row. I think it's like so slim, like maybe even less than 5%. It's like 1% or something like that, right? Because they have Mech Shaman, which is like awful versus Zoo. It's like almost unwinnable. And then they have Warlock, which is like decent. Patron is like good. That Mage is like good. And Rogue is like not that great. It's like 50-50. So...
Yeah. It's just, like, to go through Zoo with every match you got. And the thing is, they have to play their best chances first, right? Just for the team, the game wins, that is. We talked about that a bit earlier, but those end up mattering. So they'll just have to try to queue their best matchups, one after the other.
If Team Liquid had only 50%, they would have 3% to win 5 in a row.
I have a number crunch. Team Liquid has a 3.63% chance to win.
Okay.
That's good. That's a great chance, Trump.
That's better than nothing.
Yeah, it's better than zero.
About the same as a Doomsayer coming out of Shredder, right? Roughly.
Yeah, you're right. It's in the same range. On a daily basis, you're going to see it about as often.
Did you also account for the tilt factor that might come in after 3 games?
What's the weight on that? What's the weight? Is it like every single loss after the third one counts for like... Another 25%
didn't account for the tilt factor, so I'll round up Team Liquid's chance to 4%.
Okay.
That's it? Okay, tilt doesn't matter too much then.
Well, the thing is that in the first games, Team Liquid is the team being tilted, and then if they win 3 in a row, then Eloise is going to get tilted maybe.
Ah, you're right.
And you have to account like the chance of the players going on tilt and the chance of that mattering with the deck that they play.
Yeah, and then part of the factor is that tilt with Zoo doesn't matter that much.
Yeah, you're right. And I think Eloise is pretty comfortable with her deck.
And with her hand right now, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, this hand is nice.
Whoa. Well, that's not exactly a prime, like, a prime hand from Aria. He needs to find a little bit better than this. Although, what's nice about the hand that he's got is...
Oh, now it's a good hand.
Well, yeah, I was gonna say, the moment he starts finding, like, one board sweep, he's got the secrets that enable, like, duplicating Sludge Belchers and whatnot. I think it's the Iron Beak Owl, man. That Iron Beak.
It's gonna be really valuable. But now Eloise knows that Nerea has Moltens. Will she play around it? Is it correct to play around it? Since you know you have the Mech Shaman matchup, which is like super favorite, I think you just YOLO this matchup and not care about Moltens, right?
So you just run into it and like you just brute force it until you're forced into a good matchup.
Yeah. You just try to get lucky. You have a lot of
chances. To some extent though, it's really, it can matter quite a bit for Tempo Storm to kick Liquid to the curb. Because every single win that Team Liquid gets, these two teams are rather close in score. So if you keep their tiebreakers down, you have a higher chance of playing one standing higher.
Well, there's like two more weeks, so anything can change.
Yeah, but it's good to make that gap as wide as possible, given the chance. So you're right. Now the question is, do I go for the Ice Block now and Doomsayer Nova later? Or do I Doomsayer Nova now and get wrecked by Owl, because then I'm behind though?
Nerea tries to keep the Doomsayer for a lot of value. But yeah, Owl is gonna be insane. Eloise has a blank there now. She would have loved Nerea to play the Doomsayer so she can use all the mana, almost all the mana, with the Iron Beak.
I don't even mind PO half the time in this type of deck. The Dr. Boom's Boombots might be what make a huge difference in this case. Because they're going to be really hard to clear and the Ice Block might be popped just about the same time if you look at the way the board is lining up.
Here just all in tap, right?
I think so, yeah. There's really no reason to do anything else.
The next turn you just pop the block. Like, Nerea can play Molten and Mountain if he wants to.
Yeah.
He can Mountain, Coin, Molten, but is that a good play?
But I think he's going to have to Flamestrike right now. Like, his only play... I mean, I guess he could go for Molten, Sunfury, Coin, Frostbolt and kill something, like the 2-3 Defender of Argus, and that's going to give him a 0-7 with Taunt and an 8-8 with Taunt. So that's going to give him a lot of defensive possibilities, in which case the Doomsayer is not even half bad when silenced.
It's kind of interesting how the Doomsayer is going to serve as a pretty good plus 7 health.
Yeah, you could play Mountain now as well, you know, Mountain, Sunfury, and never mind the Frostbolt play. Because you're likely not going to play Mountain any other time, and it's going to tank 8 damage.
You can also like Mountain, Sunfury, Coin, Frostbolt if you want to make don't get your bop locked.
Yeah, that was the initial play idea, but...
It's really a really hard turn for Nerea.
The coolest thing to do is to play Explosive Sheeps in this deck. I don't know if Nerea's playing them, we haven't seen any, and it's a really good card in that type of list. But some people cut them because they don't think they're as impactful as they want them to be.
And I think you have space for that. Doomsayer is pretty good right now.
Yeah.
Like a massive shield bearer. Oh man, I can't wait to play around with that new priest card. Confuse, 2 mana, all the minions get crazed alchemisted.
What? I wonder. Is there a new priest card?
Yeah, 2 mana, everybody swaps.
Is that even good?
I don't know, I just know it's cool. I don't care if it's good. You're talking to me, man, like don't even go further than this. You're thinking too deep.
I like at least playing Doomguard now before
playing
the one. Oh,
it's a good
one.
Oh my god, was that a sick Doomguard. Keep the Boom, keep the Mal'Ganis, no problem. Just
yeah, that's the reason why I played before. I like it.
What a good Doomguard that was.
Going for face. Yeah, you cannot play around Moltens. You're not in a spot where you can play around Moltens.
And now, the good thing is Flamestrike's not even that big of a worry for you. Oh wow, that is an issue. That is what I call a problem.
That's two taunted Molten Giants right there.
Yeah. 2 8-8s to go through.
That was a sick draw from Nairia.
Yeah, but that's the way the deck plays. That's kind of how it's supposed to come out. So in the end, it might work out against the zoo. It's one of the better matchups for you anyway.
What is he thinking about?
I guess Healbot and Duplicate. Healbot Frostbolt, he's gonna freeze that Doomguard.
Isn't this line like super greedy?
This is going to... Well, yeah, it's very greedy, but it's actually not gonna get punished, is the cool thing. It's greedy, but at the same time, as Echo Mage, it's the type of greedy play that you rarely ever will get punished for. Because you can then just get another Molten. The only thing I don't like from this is that you risk losing your Sun Fury if the zoo decides to play the trading game. And if he kills your Healbot, your Echo just loses drastically in value. The only upside is that you can then pop the Creeper and Flamestrike everything off the board. It's just it's a really different line of play than I guess I would have taken in the same situation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was a very interesting line of play. I'm not going to call it bad because I'm sure Nairia has played this matchup.
Well, so it's working out because Eloise is not trading, right?
Wow. Ooh.
Yeah, this is looking
I would have surely traded there, though, as Eloise.
I think he's telegraphing, hey, I'd like to maximize my Echo value. Can you please feed me some of it? And she let it slide.
What? Now you can even Echo a mad scientist if you want to be really greedy.
Because why not? Nobody needs any of those other cards. Oh man, this is so devastating for Eloise. He doesn't know
he
yet.
Wants to flame strike and not use the Echo.
Well, that's...
This is
that's
greedy.
That's a little unusual. So he loses the... Okay, wait,
oh,
I don't know. I have absolutely
oh,
no idea. You know, this doesn't seem consistent with his initial line of play. Now, I'm not sure what's happening anymore. He's going to live and probably race ahead. Like, I don't see how he's going to be behind, but...
No, I mean, the line of play was to use the Healbot to kill Dr. Doom. That would have been pretty good.
And now Eloise can just trade?
Yeah, and the Echo's dead. I think Nairia is not... I think Nairia recognizes that that was a mistake. And I mean... As an Echo Mage player, he knows it. There's no way he doesn't.
No, it wasn't necessarily a mistake, though. Because the Boombot needed to hit the Healbot. If the Healbot lives, then you kill the Dr. Boom and you win the game easily.
Okay.
Yeah, but Echo Maybe is like 100% win. I don't think the Zoo player can deal with like double taunted Molten Giants. I'm not sure. I didn't play
That's
that
true,
day,
too,
but...
since you've seen a Owl be used.
Yeah. We'll see exactly how this ends up panning out. Yeah.
It's
That's
really
what's so great about Echo. Like, Neville's had a really good list that he piloted to, what, rank 1 Legend, I think, one season. And it's a deck that he's obsessed with, right? And the way he plays it is pretty interesting because no two games resemble each other. And when you look at two players playing Echo Mage, none of them will make the same play. And I find that pretty fascinating about the deck list. It's just that it's not a very tournament, like a very heavily represented list in tournaments.
Well, Neville himself, that played the deck a lot, said that he doesn't even play it himself in tournaments. He said it's only good versus ladder players that never played versus a deck before. If you play versus a pro, he will just leave you at 20 plus
20,
health.
Yeah.
And there's like no way you win.
Yeah.
There's like no way you win because you don't have like that many threats. But Nerea's version forces you to bring him down because of the mountain. But because of the mountain, he also has like more dead cards, so he has like a higher percentage of drawing really badly. Compared to Neville's.
Aggro. I mean, yeah, against the aggro, you're going to be in a little bit more trouble, obviously.
Like, the way Nairia played it, now he's forced to draw into something, and Eloise can just drop Mal'Ganis and win.
Well, she can't quite win yet. She has to kill a mad scientist in the first place. Like, she has to abusive the creeper and kill the egg and kill a mad scientist. Otherwise, Flamestrike will take care of Mal'Ganis.
Yeah, even with just one of them, actually.
Yeah, with the ping, you're right.
And in some ways, no, this is fine. That Flamestrike's going to be really good.
Yeah, it's going to be the best Flamestrike. The 2-1-1s will stay around, but I don't think it'll be that big of a deal. Oh, wow. Okay, so you can always get an Emperor after that, and Zoo needs to then deal with a 5-5. There's another Doomguard in Eloise's deck, but Nairia has Healbots. Well, one Healbot left. and Alex, very likely, that we saw earlier. This game is dragged on and on for this matchup. It's not one that I expect to last this long, oddly enough.
Yeah, when you're playing with duplicates and sludge belchers and ice blocks, I'm not surprised. I wonder. Yeah, at this point, though, it is strongly in Aria's favor. It's going to be tough for Luis to dig up that remaining 7 damage.
Unless he gets Doomguard.
It doesn't take much. But he's got no more board wipes. That's what we have to keep in mind. Like, this Emperor is pretty cute, but it's not contesting anything for the time being. Unless Neria picks up a Blizzard. I mean, we've already seen him play 2 Flame Strikes, I think, right? And he's got a Frost Nova left. If not 2.
Ooh, I don't think that was Blizzard. He's just breaking it the old fashioned way with 5 straight damage. Okay.
When was the last time you saw that? When was the last time you saw an Ice Block get buffed? Oof. Let's see what.
I think Eloise is heavily favored now because putting Nerea at 1, he needs Alexstrasza, our boss, in the next 2 turns.
I might even just implode to get the 1/1s, obviously.
Yeah, but you proc the block.
It's you have to proc. You have to proc the block. Yeah, there's no way you don't.
Well,
I guess you could actually.
No, actually, because of duplicate, there's no reason to. No. Yeah. He can still get 2 emperors.
Yeah, but even something as innocent as Sludge Belcher might be good enough. Let's see, that's 3, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Yeah, that would be good enough, but misses.
Well, the same way you can say Eloise can get a Doomguard.
Does he play... Does he ever play a Fireball? I mean, he can play Healbot Echo if he finds one. And maybe stay alive a tiny bit longer.
I don't think you can actually fit Fireball in this deck, especially if you're
running it doesn't fit. It's one of the few decks that actually just doesn't run it straight up. There aren't a lot of mage decks that don't.
It seems like not using the Echo faster cost him the game, possibly, unless he gets Alexstrasza.
Alex would be a game-changing top deck. I mean, even Frost Nova would be at this point. If you let the board filled up like this...
Well, again, when I look back at the board, like at the time that he could have used Echo, it's astonishing that he didn't, because it was a Healbot, it was a Molten, it was a Sun Fury.
It was everything. Yeah,
it could have even been an additional Mad Scientist if he had the extra 2 mana to spare.
And he had it at that point. He could have been greedy and just copy that, but he did not.
Oh, Doomguard.
And now there could be a lethal from hand anytime soon, and suddenly Alexstrasza is not looking nearly as bad. With that Doomguard in hand, Eloise doesn't have to tap, not to risk anything in case a shenanigan happens.
And that's game.
That looks like it, yeah. I mean, you could go for Doomsayer, Echo Doomsayer, and then concede.
Well, Nerea had 2 turns of Echo.
Wow, that is by far the most polarized series we've ever had. 6-1 in the Archon Team League. That was number 1, especially fast. And very convincing from Temple Storm.
Yeah, they played really well.
Yeah, I think the plays were good. And the thing is that, like, we mentioned this earlier, but the benching, the first bench, when the Druid came out from Hyped, the kill that he got on Grim Patron was a really decisive moment. Because if that hadn't gone through, the Druid would have had to then play against other decks that it might have been less favored against. So that was a really
pivotal
probably
still
point.
Win versus the Mage, right? It's super favored, the Druid versus the Mage. So, yeah.
Well, that'll seal it for the second match of the day. Temple Storm takes it over Team Liquid. We saw earlier that Cloud9 beat Celestial. So Celestial, at the end of the day, I mean, if we look at the standings, you know, Celestial is still at the very bottom. But now, with that win, Temple Storm ranked up a little bit in game wins. I think it actually, it did pass Cloud9 and Force and Boys just as a result of that.
And Tempo Storm wasn't the only winner there. Like, Team Celestial was looking like they were out of it. But when you look at it, since Team Liquid only got 1 win, they're only 4 wins ahead in the tiebreaker. So in the forward weeks, there's some pressure on Team Liquid to not lose the next 2 and for Celestial not to win the next 2. In fact, if Team Liquid loses the next 2, then their game win score wouldn't increase by that much. And Celestial could eke out into 7th place.
Yeah, if they get, like, if Team Celestial gets a really good score and Team Liquid whiffs, basically, they could swap places. But at this point, it's almost just between those. Force and Boys, I guess, could end up in a similar spot where I think if they do get atrociously terrible results and Team Celestial and Liquid get good ones, then there's a chance they go up. But the 8th place belongs to the teams that you see in the bottom three at this point, all basically, because Team Celestial can't go above 2 more wins, right? Unless I'm mistaken.
That's correct.
Yeah. All right. Well, what's up? Are you?
Go ahead. Team Celestia will also meet Foursome Boys, I think, in the following weeks. So they have like a direct fight for relegation.
Aha. Uh-huh. Okay. So that could actually be a big series for them, for both teams, if it comes to it. So that'll wrap it up for the day, guys, and the week. In fact, we're done with the week 5. Day 1 and day 2 have been done. RDU, thanks for casting with us today. Trump as well. I hope you enjoyed the games. Good games, right?
Yep.
They were fun. So before we go, quick shout out to Amazon and AlphaDraft for sponsoring the event. The Amazon App Store is doing a giveaway for discount codes, 50% on a bunch of card packs. You can check it out, teamarcon.com/Amazon, and you can check it out for the redemption on amazon.com/Hearthstone if you want to know how it works. So until the next week, guys, have a nice one, and yeah, see you then.